بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Welcome brothers in our weekly lesson from عمدة الأحكام من كلام خير الأنام الإمام عبد الغني المقدسي. And we are in a chapter of Al-Hajj. And we are in the first chapter or a new chapter, which is about the Hadi. After we explained the farewell Hajj of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and how he did his Hajj by starting on the 25th of Dhul Qi'dah, traveled from Al-Madinah toward Mecca, and he started his Ihram from Dhul Hulaifah. Dhul Hulaifah is a miqat of Ahlul Madinah, the people of Medina, and the place there is now called Abyar Ali, the wells of Ali. And after he traveled all this distance, he spent about 9 days, and he reached Mecca on the morning of the 4th of Dhul Hijjah. And he entered Mecca from the upper side, which is Kada. And Kada with Fath indicate he entered from the upper side. And when he finished his Hajj, he left it from Kuda with Dam. So Kada with Fath is the upper side of Mecca, and Kuda with Dam is the lower side when he left the Mecca. And as we explained last time, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam ساق الهدي, he brings his hadi. And what is hadi, by the way? What is the meaning of hajj? And how many types of hajj? And what is the animal that we can sacrifice in the hajj? So this is so far will be tonight lesson inshallah about the hajj. طيب باب الهدي حديث رقم 255 عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت قلت فتلت قلائد هدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ثم أشعرها وقلدها أو قلدتها ثم بعث بها إلى البيت وأقام بالمدينة فما حرم عليه شيء كان له حل. طيب سيدة عائشة رضي الله عنها in this hadith explain that فتلت قلائد هدي النبي. What is the meaning of قلائد or قليدة? قلائد is like a tag. It is added to the sacrifice animal to indicate that this animal for Hajj, for al-Bayt, for the Kaaba. And she prepared this tag by herself. And then she said, I add this tag on the animal, or Prophet Muhammad ﷺ did that by himself. And then he sent this animal to the bait. As remember, we explain how many camel Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم sacrificed in 63. He sacrificed by his hand, but overall how many? 100. Ali ibn Abi Talib sacrificed or slaughtered 37 by his hand, and Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم sacrificed 63. طيب. Why Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم bring the hadi to al-bayt? And what is the bayt? Of course, Kaaba. As we explain in the different types of hajj, we have three types of hajj. The first one is tamattu', enjoying. Second one is qiran, combining. The third one, ifrad, single. So the single is only hajj. Ifrad means hajj only. While tamattu' has two types of tamattu', by the way. Either tamattu' with breaking in between, you enjoy the hajj and umrah in one travel, or enjoy the hajj and umrah in one travel without break, with break between umrah and hajj. So we have two options in do combination between hajj and umrah. The first option is to do tamattu', which is doing the umrah first on the months of the hajj, and which is the shawwal and the qi'dah and the 10 days of the hijjah, and then you break the umrah, finish the umrah, and then you start hajj on the 8th of Dhul Qi'dah. And the second type of hajj is the qiran, combination. You combine hajj and umrah in one travel without breaking ihram. Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said, if I know previously the situation, I would make it tamattu' instead of qiran. Because Prophet Muhammad said, because I bring with me the hadi, I make it qiran. So here is the rule. If someone has the ability to bring the hadi with him, in this case, his best hajj is qiran. Means he finished umrah and stayed in ihram and then starts the hajj. But if he are not able to bring the hadi with him, he do tamattu, means he finish the umrah and break the ihram and then stay until the Dhul Qi'dah, the 8th of Dhul Hijjah, and start the hajj. طيب. How many hajj we have? So the reason that Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم brings the hajj with him, because he combined hajj and umrah. So anyone combine hajj and umrah in one travel, he should have hajj, either tamattu' or qiran. So how many hajj of, or how many types of hajj? First one, we have the wajib hajj, the compulsory hajj or the obligatory hajj. This in case of hajj tamattu', when you have mut'a of hajj and umrah, or qiran hajj and umrah, there is a wajib. And if someone has no ability to buy the hadji or the animal, what he should do? I mentioned that last time. Yes. فَصِيَامُ ثَلَاثَةُ أَيَّامٍ فِي الْحَجِّ وَسَبْعَةٌ إِذَا رَجَعْتُمْ. To fast 3 days in the hajj, and then 7 when he returned to his country. And these 3 days could be before hajj, or even in the ayamu al-tashriq. Although the ayamu al-tashriq, which is the 11th and 12th and 13th, is a ayamu aklin wa dhikrin wa shurb, as Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it is ayam, the days of eating and drinking and dhikr, remember Allah azza wa jal. However, if someone want to fast these 3 days because he are not able to bring the hajj with him, he can fast these 3 days, the 11th, the 12th and 13th. So the first type of hajj is hajj النسك, because of the mut'a, hajj al-mut'a and hajj al-qiran, which is a wajib. If someone are not able to do it, he fast 3 days in hajj and 7 when he return back. And then another hajj, still wajib also, obligatory. If someone break the ihram restriction, in this case, he has to compensate. He has to compensate. And in order to have to compensate, he has three options. First option, صيام ثلاثة أيام, to fast 3 days. Or feed six مسكين or needy person, each one half صاع, means 12 مد. Or to sacrifice a hajj animal. So this second type of hajj, which is still obligatory. If someone break his ihram or break the condition of ihram, like if someone shave his hair or clip his nail or put perfume or wear makhit, clothes, normal clothes, or wear hat, all that breaking ihram, you have to compensate that by either fasting 3 days or feed six needy maskeen, each one half sa', or sacrifice the hajj. So this second type of hajj still wajib. The third types of hajj is the tawwa', voluntary one. This is just to seek closeness to Allah Azza wa Jal and to expand on the maskeen, the faqir, the poor people, especially in the haram. The hajj should be sacrificed and distributed in the haram. This is a condition. So you cannot sacrifice the hajj in your country. The hajj should be where? In Mecca or in the haram of Mecca. However, if there are many animal sacrificed, especially in hajj, they did that. So it is permissible to back this meat and send it to someone need that. It's not haram. But you sacrifice in the Mecca and then you distribute it from Mecca. طيب. So سيدة عائشة رضي الله عنها explain in this hadith that she prepared for Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم the qala'id, the tags that it added to the animal. And these tags could be in the ear of the animal. And in case of camel, they used to like snatching the back of the animal to bring some blood to indicate this this animal for sacrifice. And also from this hadith, it showed that it's not necessary to buy the hadji from Mecca, because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam bought it from Dhul Hulayfa, and Ali ibn Abi Talib bought it from where? From Yemen. So it is not necessary to buy it from Mecca. Although Abdullah ibn Abbas said that, or has opinion that if someone send the hadj to haram, he has a restriction like the one who has ihram until he sacrifices the animal. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't do that. طيب. Also in this chapter, عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رأى رجلا يسوق بدنة قال اركبها, قال إنها بدنة, قال اركبها, قال فلقد رأيته راكبها يساير النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. So Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم saw a man riding a camel, and he's not riding on it, just pulling the camel. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, jump in, jump in the camel, don't walk near to her. And then he said to him, it is a badana, it's a camel, means it's a camel for the hajj. And then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam repeated, ride it again. And then In the third time, he listened to, or he said to him, اركبها اركبها ويلك, destruction on you, أو ويحك. Why the man here didn't ride the camel? Because there is a concept that this animal is for Allah only Azza wa Jal. So you cannot ride this animal. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained to him, because he saw in his appearance that he need to ride this one explanation of the scholars, he need to ride on this animal. He said to him, you can just ride it bil ma'roof. There is one addition in Riwayat Muslim, said to him, irkabha bil ma'roof, means ride it with a good way. Don't overload it, the camel. So this is hadith explain that the origin or the initial in the hukm of the hajj, you cannot take any benefit from this hajj. So you can't take milk from the hajj. You can't ride on the hajj. Unless, because this is for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, unless there is a necessity to ride on the camel, as you can see in this hadith. And this is because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw that this man walking near to the animal or the camel, and he said to him, ride on that. So this shows that he can do it like a very simple thing. So from this ahadith, we have some lessons. First, the permissible to send the animal or the hajj to Mecca. Also, it is permissible to tag the hajj. And in case of camel and cow, to يعني bleed the animal from the back. And this is not, although it's some maybe hurting the animal, but this just for the benefit to indicate this animal is for hajj. Also, it is shows that the Arab or the people on this time was glorifying the hajj and respect the hajj. So they didn't ride the hajj and walk next to the hajj. طيب. الحديث الذي بعد ذلك عن علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه قال أمرني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن أقوم على بدنه وأن أتصدق بلحمها وجلودها وأجلتها وألا أعطي الجزار منها شيئا وقال نحن نعطيه من عندنا. علي بن أبي طالب said that Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم commanded him to look after for his camels, 100 camels, and give its meat and the skin and the dress on the which you put it on the back of the animal, give it as a sadaqah, and do not give the butcher anything of this sadaqah. And then he said, we give it from our side. This is the side of Allah Azza wa Jal. This meat for Allah, don't give it to the jazzar or to the butcher. And here we have a very important point, especially in Eid al-Adha. When you do the Qurban in Eid al-Adha, some people bring a butcher to do it for them, and they give from the meat to him. No, he has to take his money, not the meat. The meat, this is for sadaqah. Very good question. The camel meat, especially the camel meat, there is two opinions about the camel meat. The Hanabila have the opinion that if you eat the camel meat, you have to make a wudu. The Jumhur al-Ulama said it not necessary, it is recommended but not compulsory to have a wudu. But just to exit from these differences in opinion, if you eat a camel meat, just make wudu, just precautions. Yes. So, Ali ibn Abi Talib, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded him to look after for the camels and to give sadaqah of the meat, the skin, and the dress or the clothes that put it in the back of the animal, and do not give the butcher anything. طيب, from this hadith, it shows that you cannot give to the butcher any kind of meat as a kind of a salary. He has to take his salary instead of the meat. طيب, next hadith, it will explain how you sacrifice a camel or how can you slaughter the camel. عن زياد بن جبير رحمه الله قال رأيت بن عمر رضي الله عنهما قد أتى على رجل قد أناخ بدنته فنحرها فقال بعثها قياما مقيدة سنة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. طيب, زياد بن جبير one of the تابعين from البصرة or البصرة, both correct. In this hadith he said that he saw Abdullah ibn Umar pass through a man, and this man put his camel on the ground and he started to slaughter the camel with a knife. And then he said to him, you have to make it stand and tight the left hand. And then instead of slaughtering, hit her in this point, the neck here. So when you slaughter the camel, you're not slaughtering like the cow or like yes, you just hit in this place while he's standing. This is the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم in nahr, and we have a slaughter or dhabh and nahr. Nahr means that you're not cutting these two veins. You hit it here, so the blood comes from this side. This is the sunnah of Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم in nahr al-ibil. طيب, this is alhamdulillah finished the chapter of al-hajj. Next chapter, still in Hajj as well, باب الغسل للمحرم, the غسل or the shower for the محرم. As you know, there is some restriction for the محرم. Some of the restriction, he cannot add or put any perfume, or he cannot shave the hair, clip the nail, and he cannot do any marriage contract. He cannot marry. So what about shower? What about ghusl? And it is permissible to have ghusl. Listen to this hadith. عن عبد الله بن حنين رضي الله عنه وفيه أن عبد الله بن عباس رضي الله عنهما والمسور بن مخرمة رضي الله عنهما اختلفا بالأبواء فقال ابن عباس يغسل المحرم رأسه وقال المسور لا يغسل المحرم رأسه قال فأرسلني ابن عباس إلى أبي أيوب الأنصاري فأرسلني ابن عباس إلى أبي أيوب الأنصاري رضي الله عنه فوجدته يغتسل بين القرنين وهو يستتر بثوب فسلمت عليه فقال من هذا؟ فقلت أنا عبد الله بن حنين أرسلني إليك ابن عباس يسألك كيف كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يغسل رأسه وهو محرم فوضع أبو أيوب يده على الثوب فطأطأه حتى بدا لي رأسه ثم قال لإنسان يصب عليه الماء أصبب فصب على رأسه ثم حرك رأسه بيده فأقبل بهما وأدبر ثم قال هكذا رأيته صلى الله عليه وسلم يفعل. وفي رواية قال المسور لابن عباس لا أماريك بعدها أبدا. طيب, in this hadith عبد الله بن حنين تابعي مولى ابن عباس, the slave of ابن عباس, from Medina, and he's from the middle level of the tabi'in. والمصور ابن مخرمة, and his father is a sahaba, and he died in Mecca in the fitna that happened in the time of Abdullah ibn Zubayr after the killing of al-Husayn, and then Yazid became Khalifa according to the Muawiyah. Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, he gave him the nomination to be a Khalifa. Abdullah ibn Zubayr and the Sahaba refused the Yazid, as we explained here before, and they nominate Abdullah ibn Zubayr as a Imam, as a Khalifa, and he took the bay'ah from Mecca and Medina. But unfortunate, Yazid sent an army and killed Abdullah ibn Zubayr. So also Musawwar ibn Makhrama killed in the same time of that. He hated by a rock. As we explained before, they use a manjaniq or a device that throwing the rocks towards the Kaaba. So this Musawwar ibn Makhrama is a Sahabi Jalil, and Abdullah ibn Hunayn is Tabi. What happened? Al-Musawwar ibn Makhrama and Abdullah ibn Abbas has disputed on the opinions of does the muhrim can take shower or not. يعني if you have ihram and you are doing umrah, it's permissible for you to take shower or not. So al-Musawwar said no, because maybe while he doing ghusl some hair dropped, and as we explained that cutting the hair, it is not permissible in ihram. But Abdullah ibn Abbas said no. He no. Wudu does not break by that. So then they have differences in this opinion. Abdullah ibn Abbas sent Abdullah ibn Hunayn to another Sahabi, Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. And Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, when Abdullah ibn Hunayn went to him, he was in ihram and he's taking shower. And then Abdullah ibn Hunayn went to him and asked him a very important questions. He said, Abdullah ibn Abbas sent me to ask you how was Prophet Muhammad used to wash his head while he is in ihram. Look the questions. He didn't say to him, if it is permissible for the muhrim to wash his head or not. He said what? How was Prophet Muhammad washing his head? Because this is the reference. You need to know what is the action of Prophet. Doesn't matter the hukm, you need to know if Prophet did that or not. And then Abu Ayyub was taking shower. And in the bath, they used to take a shower near to the well. You know the well? Yeah. And you have like two sticks, and they put the bucket on this and take the bucket from the well. And he was putting his clothes on these sticks, and he was hiding behind these sticks. And then when Abdullah ibn Hunayn reached to him, he saw him taking shower. And then he opened the curtain he added, and he get his head outside. And then he asked his one man around him to bring a water to throw it on his head. And then he showed demonstration to him, and he used his hand in his head from the front to the back, front to the back. So he washed normal, yes, like that. So this means that's permissible. Doesn't matter it can some hair comes or not. Because if you worried about the hair, you will not take shower. So this means that the muhrim can take shower, even some hair came from his head. طيب. From this hadith, we have lessons.
Hmm. The
Yes, if it normal hail falling, no problem. Yeah, but if it comes accidentally without any intention, no problem. طيب, the benefit here from this hadith, it is permissible for the muhrim to wash his head and his body and to move his hair with his hand. Second, as you know in Hajj, this was in Hajj by the way. As we know in Hajj, Allah said, فَلَا رَفَثَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ وَلَا جِدَالٍ. There is no dispute in the Hajj. So how we can explain that Al-Musawwar ibn Makhramah and Abdullah ibn Abbas had a dispute in opinions and start to conversate in Hajj. Each one is try to bring the evidence on his hukm or his rule. This is not a dispute, a negative dispute. This is in ilm, in knowledge. If you have a good communication, explain your opinion with the evidence and the other explain your opinion, his opinion with the evidence, this is not a dispute that break or decrease the reward of Hajj. طيب. No perfume, no even shampoo. If there's a shampoo with a perfume, don't use it. If it have a fragrance, don't use it. But if it, without any fragrance, you can use it. طيب, next chapter on last hadith tonight, inshallah. باب فسخ الحج إلى العمرة. عن جابر بن عبد الله رضي الله عنهما قال أهل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأصحابه بالحج وليس معه أحد منهم هدي غير النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وطلحة طلحة بن عبيد الله رضي الله عنه وقدم علي من اليمن ومعه هدي فقال أهللت بما أهل به النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فأمر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أصحابه أن يجعلوها عمرة فيطوفوا ثم يقصروا ويحلوا إلا من كان معه الهدي فقالوا ننطلق إلى منى وذكروا أحدنا يقتر فبلغ ذلك النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال لو استقبلت من أمري ما استدبرت ما أهديت ولولا أن معي الهدي لأحللت وحاضت عائشة رضي الله عنها فنسكت المناسك كلها إل غير أنها لم تطف بالبيت فلما طهرت طافت بالبيت قالت يا رسول الله تنطلقون بحجة وعمرة وأنطلق بحج فأمر عبد الرحمن بن أبي بكر أن يخرج معها إلى التنعيم فاعتمرت بعد الحج. This long hadith, very simple. It just describing the حجة الوداع. We explained that before, but we focus more again. Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم in this hadith as Jabir ibn Abdullah. And by the way, Jabir ibn Abdullah is the most Sahabi that described the حجة الوداع perfectly. In full details, حديث جابر في الصحيحين وفي البخاري بالأخص, it's combined all the steps of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم since he traveled from Medina until he returned. طيب, he said that Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم أهل means he start إحرام بالحج and he has هدي, he brings the animal with him as well as طلحة. طلحة بن عبيد الله, one of the 10 Sahaba that has got tiring of Jannah. So no one has hadi except him and طلحة. So and then Ali bring or comes from the Yemen with a hadi. And then he said, I will do the same nusuk, the same ihram, the same sha'ira, the same hajj like Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم because he brings the animal with him from the Yemen. And then Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم commands his Sahaba who don't have the hadi to make it umrah and finish it. Do tawaf and then either to cut the hair, not the shave, and then get free or break the ihram. Then if you don't have, unless someone have had, he stay on ihram. Then the Sahaba was يعني, worried or we are not happy because how can we break ihram and then we stay normal until the Hajj, so everyone can have a relation with his wife during this time. How can we go to this in this time after we have a relation with our wife, go to the Hajj? And then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained to them that if I know previously the situation, I would not bring the Hajj. And because of this, I am the Hajj, I will not break my ihram. But if I return back to the previous time, I will not bring the Hajj with me and make it Umrah, like he did to him. And then on the same travel, Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha has her mysterious cycle, and she did all the sha'air except the tawaf and sa'i. And when she became pure, she did the tawaf. And then she said to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "O Prophet, everyone will return with Hajj and Umrah, but I just will return with Hajj because she break her Umrah and she don't have time to do Umrah. Because she waited until she become pure." And then he commanded Abdul Rahman, her brother, to take her to At-Tan'im and then start Umrah after the Hajj. So from this hadith, you can take some lessons. If you have the animal with you, you can stay with your Umrah until the Hajj and combine both together. But if you don't have the animal with you, what you should do? You break your Umrah and cut, not shave, your hair, because you need some hair for the Hajj. So you do cutting of the hair. And also from this hadith, we can take that if the woman have her cycle, she cannot do the tawaf or the sa'i. She should wait. But if she are in a travel with a group and she has to travel with them, she need to find a way, because the tawaf al-ifada is a compulsory, is a pillars of Hajj. And if there is no tawaf ifada, there is no Hajj. So she can find a way to wait until to do the tawaf al-ifada. As said, Aisha waited and then she do the tawaf and finish the Hajj. And then she said to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Everyone will return with Hajj and Umrah, but only I did Hajj." So he sent her with one of his mahrim, his brother Abdul Rahman, to At-Tan'im, which is about 10 minutes far from Mecca, and she returned back with a Hajj, with the Umrah. So as you can see, you can finish your Umrah and then wait to the Hajj. This is the end of tonight lesson, inshallah. So any question in 1 minute? Yes? Oh, very good question. Why you go to Tan'im? Tan'im is in Hill. So in Mecca we have Haram and Hill, means the lawful and unlawful. Unlawful to do hunting, unlawful to kill animal, unlawful to cut the tree. This is Haram. There are boundaries. If you exceed these boundaries, it become Hill. Like At-Tan'im, like Al-Ja'rana, like Al-Hudaybiyah, like Arafah, all this Hill, like Mina, all this Hill. So in order to make Umrah, you should start your Umrah outside the Haram, not from the Haram. Except if you are from Meccan people, if you are from the people of Mecca. But if you are not from Meccan people, you have to go outside the Haram to the Tan'im, to Al-Ja'rana, to Al-Hudaybiyah, to Mina, to Arafat, to come with Umrah back. Plus, جزاكم الله خيرا. See you tomorrow, inshallah, for Islamic discussion night. And we have still talking about the Islamic finance and some of the important rules in the Islamic finance, inshallah. See you tomorrow, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.